making sure your eyes and brain can cope with their environment, understand it, and act upon that information is vital to all seafarers. As vital today as it was to the pilots and air crew of flying boats like this in the Second World War, as they patrolled the open spaces of the Atlantic searching for U-boats. They had blind flying instruments, but they still lived and died by their control of perception, seeing in time and understanding what was all about them. Now, new research, sponsored by CHIRP, shows how important that still is.
Using findings from real-life situations, data from the IMO, and new research led by the Arts and Sciences and Neuroscience departments at University College London, perception, decision-making, and fatigue at sea informs seafarers and shipping managers on the limits of eye and brain for seafarers, and how these limits can be managed and not crossed. This film, Vision and Decision, is an introduction to that report and shares its vital aim, safer seas for all.
First, how does the eye work, and what are its outer limits? Eyes are made of two kinds of cell. Rod cells give us black and white vision, light sensitivity in darkness, and detection of movement on the edge of vision. But the rod cells have a night blind spot. This has obvious implications for anyone on the bridge of a ship during the dark hours, when, as IMO data shows, more severe and very severe incidents occur. This blind spot happens when we look directly at something for a number of seconds. Cone cells in the eye deliver colour vision and fine detail, such as will enable a watchkeeper to observe and identify an approaching or passing vessel. So we have in fact two types of vision. One for fast movement and low light, and another for detail in good light. All of this explains something very familiar to seafarers, that it takes time to adjust between high and low light sources and environments found on the bridge at night, with bright screens right in front of us and the dark beyond the bridge windows. In fact, it can take a full half hour for that adjustment to happen in full, not practical for watchkeepers. The answer? Spend time in an environment illuminated by reddish light, so that what is around you looks like this. The longer wavelength of red light is better for the rods, the part of the eye that works best at night. But there are many other factors playing into a seafarer's vision and decision. Older people need more light, and find it harder to deal with motion, the unexpected and dim displays. Rapidly switching between daylight and dim, dark adapted conditions confuses the body's clock, hitting alertness and the ability to assess and decide. Shift work also creates long-term fatigue, which affects our ability to see and decide, and is associated over time with a decline in the brain's performance. Such tiredness also creates visual fatigue, with just four moving objects, the most our brains can handle at any one time. All of that is made more complex by how our brains work with our eyes. Scientists divide the eye's functions into what and where. The what delivers detail and colour using the centre of the eye. It needs bright light for optimum performance. The where system works better in dim light, using peripheral vision, and is better adapted to transient event moments, such as moving objects. But what and where use different parts of the brain, so they can't both be at peak performance at the same time. Of course, it isn't just how the brain works that affects vision and decision, it's how we work it too. When we look downwards at work screens such as ECDIS, we use our lower visual field. This is more sensitive than the upper. When looking out of the bridge window, as any watchkeeper must, over the screen without straightening the body, we're using less sensitive parts of the eye, and so not at our visual best. This is important, because what we think we see in terms of size and distance is often not the real thing. if we underestimate or overestimate size, we get distance wrong. And the further off an object is, the more likely we are to get its size wrong. It's important to remember you're not on your own. Just as the students working on this report collaborated to produce its findings, so too should seafarers when making key decisions. But why is that much the best way to go?
The culture and communication on board a ship are really important in terms of a ship running smoothly as well as avoiding emergency situations. So it's really important that the crew have a closed-loop communication system that allows for feedback and ensures that the crew are checking in on each other at every step of the process.
So seafarers perform a balancing act between trusting one's experience and one's electronic equipment, and over-reliance on one of both two will lead to stressful situations and dangerous decisions.
The cliche, two heads are better than one, is actually based in truth. A collective perception is much better than an individual one. We found that when in groups, we tend to communicate and reach a compromise, which is usually more accurate than our own separate estimates. So this, we believe, is at the root of good crew decision making.
Many accidents at sea happen because individual crew members make decisions on their own, avoiding discussions with others. By involving other members of crew, there is less chance of error. So asking someone, what do you think about this, is never a sign of weakness.
This report includes recommendations important for seafarers, managers, and maritime regulators when considering the human element in ship design and when writing operating procedures. The key is improving how we see, giving attention to what and where, lighting and dark adaptation, and improving too how we decide on a course of action, keeping communication, culture, trust, and group decisions constantly in mind, and always being aware of how to deal with fatigue. Think and act now. Take a moment to read the report. Think of your eyes, your brain, how you make decisions in groups, and your health.